Hello, welcome to my channel, Medicine with Dr. Moran. I'm Dr. Keith Moran. Today I want to talk about additional research in regards to vaccine-induced thrombosis, which has been well documented with the adenoviral vector vaccines, in other words, the AstraZeneca and J&J. It's highly likely to be present in the other adenoviral vector vaccines, such as the Russian vaccine, Sputnik. I have previously talked about the possible pathophysiology of how these adenovirus vector vaccines lead to blood clots and ultimately low platelets. Now, low platelets occur through a mechanism where the platelets get soon consumed in the clot, so when we measure the platelet values, they're quite low. Now, this condition is similar to what we call heparin-induced blood clots and low platelets. Heparin is a blood thinner that we use to prevent and treat blood clots. Now this week, some new additional information on the pathophysiology of vaccine-induced blood clots was reported in the Journal of Science Advances. There's a link to the research paper in the description below. Now, understanding how the mechanism, that is, how these vaccines induce blood clots, which can be fatal, is important, not just to prevent the outcome, but also to treat it. We also need to understand this because we use adenovirus viral vectors to deliver treatments. Now, just a quick recap on this particular condition. The frequency is on the order of 1 in 30,000 to about 1 in 100,000. A review at the end of July in the journal Blood reviewed the United Kingdom experience with AstraZeneca and the US experience with J&J up to sometime in July. As you can see on the slide, there are a number of cases of cerebral vein thrombosis. This is an unusual kind of blood clot that we can see involving the veins of the brain, and these veins drain the brain, and of course if you get blood clots in there, it will not drain the brain properly. It's an unusual diagnosis. I must say I've only managed a couple of people with this in my 30-year career. Blood clots also were being found in other areas which were not usual, including the abdominal blood vessels. The majority of the blood clots were seen after the first dose. 18% of people in the UK group died and 11% in the US group, so pretty significant mortality. Now, previous studies, which I've reported on previously, highlight the role of platelet factor 4, which we know is what happens with this heparin-induced blood clotting. It can occur in veins as well as arteries, just like the vaccine-induced condition I'm talking about. Here's the research paper. The researchers studied three different adenovirus vectors, which have been deployed as vaccination vectors in the different SARS-CoV-2 vaccines. This model of the AstraZeneca viral vector, they had to determine. They had to elucidate where there might be binding with platelet factor 4 and how it actually would bind and whether it was plausible. They ultimately showed that the adenovirus vector combined with platelet factor 4 via an electrostatic interaction, something like something electrically positive joining with something electrically negative. In other words, opposites attracting. They showed that a stable complex gets formed with the vector and platelet factor 4. Now, platelet factor 4 is only present in the bloodstream. So this kind of interaction does not occur in muscle cells where the vaccine might be. They did look at a common medication called fondaparinux, which is an anticoagulant that I've used many times for both acute coronary syndrome, such as heart attacks, as well as blood clots in the leg and the lung. And they found that this medication reduces the number of binding events with the adenovirus vector surface from AstraZeneca and platelet factor 4. So it ablates this electronegative potential between there and inhibits the binding, suggesting that this might be a plausible treatment. Now, their study was performed in test tubes on the bench in the laboratory, not in humans, but they did show the platelet factor 4 does contact the surface of this adenovirus vector when allowed to freely move around in simulations. Vaccine-induced blood clots typically occur 5 to 24 days after vaccination, which is the time frame where you're going to get an antibody response. Now, complete elucidation of what truly happens has not completely been worked out, but this schematic provides the best evidence that we have as to what's happening so far. Now, first, someone will get vaccinated, and somehow the vector enters the bloodstream, either by an injection that does not truly go into the muscle. In other words, it goes into a small blood vessel directly due to injection technique, or more specifically, lack of aspiration, and the needle is actually in the blood vessel when the injection occurs. If there's damage to tiny capillary blood vessels as the needle is inserted, where small amounts of the vaccine might be able to gain access to the bloodstream, even though the vaccine might be placed correctly into the deltoid muscle. This could be the case as well. Perhaps there's another mechanism which I haven't thought of, where some vaccine particles can actually access the bloodstream. Then in schematic 2, as you can see, there is that electrostatic positive and negative attraction of platelet factor 4 to the vector. And the complex then gets engulfed by other cells because they see it as being foreign. They send it to one of your lymph nodes, which then stimulates the B cells in the lymph nodes to generate anti-platelet factor 4 antibodies or antibodies against the whole complex. Now, these antibodies then activate platelets, and a number of factors are released, which causes more platelets to clump together and more platelet factor 4. Ultimately, it causes clot formation and thus the syndrome of vaccine-induced blood clots and low platelets. Again, the platelets are low because all of the platelets are bound within the clot and they're not freely circulating in the bloodstream. Now, this is important research for many reasons, as I mentioned earlier. This key feature is that this happens in the bloodstream. And while we can't definitively say that this happens due to vaccination technique, it could certainly be. It's obviously important when injecting the needle into the deltoid muscle that you deliver the vaccine into the muscle and not into a tiny blood vessel. As I mentioned previously, on this particular video, this does happen based on surveys of nurses that have given intramuscular injections over the years. Many of them have said that they have aspirated blood just before they're about to inject the intramuscular injection. And so they always check before they inject. Now, it would be terrible to find out down the road that this is something to do with side effects. That's the lack of aspiration, when it could have been preventable. Of course, we don't know that that's definitely the cause. There's lots of vaccinations going on, and a randomized trial would be interesting and could definitively answer the question. It wouldn't be that difficult to do. You would obviously need a lot of patients given the low frequency of the side effects involved, but of course, we are vaccinating a lot of people right now. I have told my patients who I've encouraged vaccination to make sure that they ask the person doing the vaccination to aspirate before injection. It's such a small accommodation of only about 3 seconds. It makes me think about all the requests that my patients often ask me for, reasonable requests. I think of things like medications that they may or may not want before a procedure or at other times. Sometimes they have requests of getting them positioned in a certain spot for their endoscopy just before I'm about to sedate them. They might want an extra pillow or a pillow between their knees to make sure that their back is comfortable while they're asleep for 20 minutes. If their accommodations are reasonable and not harmful, I always follow their wishes. Often it doesn't take any additional time, but it shows that I care. It shows people that I'm listening to them, and it allows for shared decision making, which is crucial in the doctor-patient relationship. It ultimately means that they will be happy, and so will I. Asking for someone to aspirate before injecting, as I did before both of my vaccinations, is not much to ask, for even if it's not the usual way that the vaccinator might perform their task. Healthcare providers should always be receptive to those that they're delivering care to. Being inflexible or emphatic in their beliefs and deciding that it's their way or the highway, so to speak, that has no place in medicine. Thanks for joining me today on Medicine with Dr. Moran. I'm Dr. Keith Moran. Get healthy and stay healthy.